Italia, this is a joint presentation.
Too much. And
People in businesses like yours, in particular, have more temptation, for obvious reasons, to keep more money in your pocket because it's just darn too difficult to make. Next reason is this. So when he knocks on your door and asks you to, okay, fine, I understand, you had all these expenses, all these wonderful losses, but now you have to prove it to me. And when I say this proven, well, I don't know, I have all of my receipts, they're right here. Then we will organize. So of course, okay, which one do you want to see? I have everything perfect. So that's another reason. One more reason is you guys live on the road. When you live on the road, one of the most important deductions that you take on your return is deduction for driving. Guess what? When he looks at that, he asks for mileage log. And that's an item which is notoriously absent from most of the people supporting documentation. So it's very easy. That's one of the first questions that he will ask you if he's talking to you. Okay, so you have this big $15,000 deduction for driving. Nice. Can I see your mileage log? Okay, next. And at the time when you do make a lot of money, when you do have money, make so much money that you can blow it here on the course, at that point, taxes come in. And what comes as a surprise is how much. You look at that general information, very simple articles in Houston Chronicle, that's my pet peeve. People who write for the Houston Chronicle have no idea what they're writing about on any topic, but particularly when it comes to finances. And they said, oh, your tax bracket is what, maybe 15%, 25%? Okay, so that's what you are going to pay on the money that you made, and that's not true. It could be as low as 15, but could be as high as 40 on the money that is left after you took all the deductions. And that does come like a big surprise. By the way, if you think this is outrageous, then be happy that you are members of the Houston Association of Realtors and not San Francisco Association of Realtors, or God forbid, New York Association of Realtors, where you will add state taxes on top of that. We at least don't have the state tax anymore. So enough of those. Now what I want to spend some time on is give you a few ideas and a few tips and a few good practices that can help you stay out of trouble. You should have that one-page handout which guides us through 10 what I call life savings techniques, and let's go through them one by one. Here is the first one. The first one is, remember we talked about keeping all the receipts and mileage low. Prior to current times, you guys have a legitimate excuse because what is the most difficult? Why those mileage logs and expense log, particularly mileage log, was missing? Because, well, it's darn difficult to do that. It's no longer, there is actually today absolutely no excuse for you guys to not have it. Everybody here, from what I have seen, has a phone on you. There are dozens, literally, of applications that do that for you. All you have to do is, when you left house, before this lunch, you had to push a button so it starts recording. When you came here, you would have pressed it again and that would have recorded trip from home here, and now you're going back to the office. From here to office, it should grab that again. And all it takes for you is when you use your phone for GPS purposes, it's already built in anyway. So all you have to do is just initiate that. So today, there is literally no excuse for not doing that. So first one was use apps for expense of mileage log. Second thing that I would highly recommend that everybody in this room does, open a separate business account. Separate business account for your realtor business. It doesn't matter how large or small your business is. Do you do it full-time, part-time, one closing a month or 20 closings a month. Separate business account and then make sure that everything related to business is paid from business account and vice versa, which sometimes gets pretty challenging. So here we come to the third one. My third one was when you are trying to decide Whether you pay from personal or business account, use what I term cubicle rule. Think about the times, the old good times, when you were sitting in a cubicle and had a stable paycheck coming every time. And at that time, imagine your boss comes to you and says, we're a little low on paper in the office. On the way to the office, would you stop and pick up some paper? Well, let's say that you even agreed to do that. What would be the next one? What's the next step after doing that? Yeah, you're going to turn it in and request it in person. The exactly same concept should apply when you have personal account and business account. If you forgot your business card at home or while at the restaurant entertaining good folks from Capital Concepts and picked up their lunch, paid for that, and accidentally charged it on a personal business card, what should happen next? Just like at the company, you should get reimbursed from your business account into your personal account. The other one is also true. You can never pay your dentist from your business account. It doesn't make it a business deduction. Just like you couldn't, working back in the cubicle, you couldn't go to your boss and say, you know what, I'm a little low right now, but with this ache, I can't really work productively. Would you cover my bill for me, please? So that is the rule. And remember, imagine you're working for somebody else, not for yourself, and that determines which one you pay. Sometimes it gets difficult, which comes to number four, because there are certain things that you pay for which are mixed use. Mixed use will be driving, number one, the most important thing. So when you put gas in your car, yes, absolutely, you may be spending 90% of your driving for realtor business, but you still have 10% personal, 5% personal, 0.5%, whatever that is, but it's mixed. The same would be for your cell phone bill, unless you have two different phones. One is used for personal purposes and one for business, but in reality, probably it's one bill, so it's divided. When that happens, it's very simple to remember, but I want you to mark it down there. Okay, if it's the business, which on the left side, you would be paying it with business account. If it's personal, if it's in the middle and mixed personal, not business, you could still take that as a deduction later, but you should be paying that out of personal funds, which means when you put gas in your car, don't use business card for that, unless your car is exclusively business vehicle. If you have two cars and one is only being used, you know, you drive your BMW when you do for work, but for all personal, you have a, you know, Ford 350, well, yes.
Would public relations go into this?
Would public relations go to that? Good question. It would be, if public relations is part of your realtor business, then yes. When you say public relations, it's okay. It would depend. If you are doing public relations for the Rotary Club, that becomes maybe, you know, more difficult, or for Trump campaign, you know, that is a different type of public relation.
Oh, wait, okay, yes. What I meant was if I take a family to dinner.
If you take a family to dinner, okay, that it's not here, but it's a very good question. I appreciate you bringing that up. If you take a family to dinner, if you take anybody to dinner or pay money for absolutely anything, the question to ask yourself is very scientific and difficult, but I recommend you write it down. The question you ask yourself is this: if I was not a realtor, would I have done that? Would I have paid for that? So if your family came from out of town for Thanksgiving and you take them, and you feed them, it's kind of, I doubt you did it because you are a realtor, unless all your clients are family. Yep. You know, which is kind of sort of argument you can make. But understand is okay, when we are talking to this guy, he is not exactly the dumbest person you can talk to, not the smartest, but not the dumbest. So here is the test that I developed when I, in the good old times, Blake remembers those times, but because we know each other for a long time, and used to be next door neighbors, I at that time worked at my home office, out of my house. So Blake would actually walk to my home office. And there, in my home office, I had a full-length mirror. And we called that thing, I called it Michael's mirror test. It went like that. Tell the story that you just told me into that mirror three times without cracking a smile. If you can do it, then we can tell that story to this guy. But if I, when you start telling the story, the first thing comes is, you know what, and when I went there, I had to buy, that you listen to, smile with you, you know, cross it on your tax return and take it from there. So, can you take something as a deduction? I would say, yes, as long as with a straight face, you can say that the deduction was necessary for, to run your business as a realtor, and we are all storytellers. You know, I'm in my business, you're in yours, so we can find a story that fits, but the story has to be real. Okay, number five should be self-explanatory. I presume everybody expected that. Number five was keep your receipts. Yes, we still need to keep receipts, even though you may have recorded everything on your app. Because recording something on your app does not by itself prove that it was actually paid. So, in order to satisfy suspicion of this guy, you would still need, when it comes to that, to show a receipt. The question is, what if I did not keep any receipts? Is it the end of the road? No. With qualified help, you could survive an IRS audit without receipts. But guys, that's expensive. I can help you, but it's much cheaper to keep those receipts because this thing costs a few bucks. Hiring me to defend you costs a few thousand bucks. There is a little bit of a difference. And when we talk about that, I, by the way, want to point out some tiny detail that is here, may not be obvious. Where I want to keep your receipts is in something like this, exactly what is pictured. And the critical part of that, you know what? Not separators. It's good to have compartments. You can do it by month, by category, yes. But there is more important piece of that. Can you tell me what? The ribbon is the most important part here. Because once you put it here, you can close it. I see a lot of people trying to keep receipts in yellow folders. Okay, it takes one drop on the floor and you will keep this finished after that. So keep it in something that you can close. Yes, ma'am.
So this year I called myself being more organized. So I decided to print out my bank statements as my receipt. But then after the months went on, I started thinking that doesn't give a detail of what I spent. Would that propose an issue?
Very good question. The question was about printing bank statements being organized on that side. Yes, printing bank statements is necessary, but there are a couple of things that I want to expand on when we talk about that. First, number one, if you took my advice, number two, and created a separate business account, after printing business account, you should only have their business expenses, nothing else. And conversely, if you print your personal bank or credit card account, there should be nothing related to business. In reality, pretty much every one of my clients brings those statements and it's a mixture. That's when it gets difficult. That's why I stress it. Very important to keep separate accounts. Now, even if you have an account which is either 100% business or mixed, but you took a highlighter and separated everything business on that, that's still not enough for the IRS. And here is why. When you try to prove something to the IRS, you have four components to prove of every expense. Number one would be how much. Two, when. Three, who you paid it to. So how much, when, and who you paid it to. That's easy. That you can find on the credit card statement or bank statement. But there is a fourth component that you cannot find there. And that's where the problem is. What will be the fourth component? Why? The fourth component will be why. Because here is a thing that happens a lot. Right now, my office building is facing Walmart, neighborhood Walmart store. We buy at Walmart neighborhood store things for our business. You know, office supplies, drinks, various things. So But we also could buy and do buy their personal things like groceries and things like that. So if I go there and I bring a receipt on my credit card statement that says I paid $50 to Walmart, it tells nothing. What did I buy there? Was it business related or no? That's where additional reporting has to be done. You can mark up every receipt, but that's cumbersome. So I'm going back to my number one, which was use an app for that. The app should allow you to record what that expense was for. And then the receipt will be simply supporting information. Guys, I will send around while I continue talking this sign up page, and I want to clarify what this one is. You don't have to put your name there if you do not want to receive newsletters from my company, which we send for real estate and tax-related tips. If you are interested in receiving that, please do put your name and email there. If not, just pass it along, please. Thank you very much. Next. So, number six, we're still talking about receipts, but number six has this one. Scan your receipts, not just keep a scan. Because receipts have a tendency to do two things which we don't like about them. Number one, what do they do? Yeah, they fade and they get lost. Now, it's interesting that they fade just in time when you need them. When you're about to, like, I always joke that Home Depot has an ingenious design. Their receipts fade exactly 89 days after you paid them, like one day before the last day of return. Okay, when the audits happen, how soon, do you know? If you right now file your return for 2014, okay, when the IRS might be looking at your return? Now? Right now, next month? About 2 years from now. So 2 years from now, you will be reaching into your Cordium folder, looking at those receipts, and they are unreadable at that point. Now, those things, scanners, the type that we have here, you can actually plug it into your car. They cost less than $100 if you buy them online, $200 if you buy them at the store. There are all kinds of different technologies right now. Yes, you can do it with the phone too. There are apps on the phone where you just make pictures. It's a little bit more difficult because that requires you to be good with making pictures on the phone. Scanners do much better quality than that, but phone is simpler and always in your hands. So if not scanner, then make pictures of those receipts using one of the apps. You will be happy you did that if one time down the road you do have to talk to the IRS about that. Number seven says, avoid making money. You know, the more money you make, the more taxes you have to face. Okay. No, actually what I mean here is avoid cash payments. Ever. Okay, if it wasn't clear, I didn't mean avoid making money. That was meant to be a joke. Real finances avoid paying anybody in cash, if at all possible. Now, here's an example. A couple of you didn't register for this luncheon, came here and were paying for the lunch. If you did that in cash, you didn't do too well on the bookkeeping side. You cannot scan anything right now. Chances are, when it comes time to go to your CPA and do your tax return, you might very well forget that you had to pay $25 for a business lunch, and that is a legitimate business deduction. If you instead charge that or roll a check for that, anybody still uses checks? Yes. In ATR? Okay, so those pieces of paper just. I had to remind in some places that what that is, like show picture, that's what check is. You know, but those things have some paper trail, those don't. Number eight has to do with the situation when your business is already successful and you're making money. So this guy is coming after you and will want your taxes. But it was simple back at the time when you had W-2 from work. Because every paycheck has tax withheld. So by the time the year is finished, you usually get a refund because they take too much taxes out of your check already. When you're making commission checks, nobody is taking taxes out. So first we need to get some idea what to do about it. Do you remember my 15 to 40% scare number? Mm-hmm. Okay, here is what that number applies, so let's be clear about that. So, if you are taking the commission check, first we are talking about your cut only. So if you are splitting commission, if the check, if you are broker and sharing with your agent, if in any other situation, if you are doing rebate for a customer or whatever, we are looking at what you made on the commission, just your remaining portion. So let's say that your remaining portion is $5,000 on the deal. That's still not the amount that is taxed. Because when you add up all your commissions for the year, you will have business expenses. Expenses like your marketing, memberships in organizations, your attorneys and accountants, your phones, your driving, your computers, everything you spend. You subtract that from your total. And what is left? That's the amount that is taxed. But that amount will be taxed between 15 and 40%. And no, I cannot take anybody how much. That number does not have a simple formula. You know, you can think this guy or more precisely our Congress for creating such a ridiculously complicated system, but there is no way to tell. And the number doesn't even grow steady. So if you make more money, does it mean that you pay more taxes? Maybe, maybe not. The calculation is very complicated, but between 15 and 40. So optimistic, number will be 15. Okay, pessimistic 40, so I'm trying to hit somewhere in the middle and my rule will be set aside one third from your net commission check. So once you close on the deal, you got commission. Think how much of that is left in your pocket and set one third of that for taxes, because eventually that's what you will have to pay. If you want to be more, this is a conservative. One third is a conservative benchmark. You want to be a little bit, take a little more risk, you can reduce it to one fourth. But below one fourth, I consider it being risky. If you leave less than one fourth of your commission for taxes, chances are you're not going to be a happy camper in the spring when your taxes are finished and you see your bill. Now, what do I mean set it aside? Okay. Whatever you do with it, put it in a different account or something, guys, it's not going to work. Let's be honest about it. If throughout the year you are setting aside money and waiting until next April 15th to pay your entire 20,000 bill, okay, I'm not even asking, raise your hand if you've ever done that, because even if you raise your hand, I won't believe you, sorry. Okay. I won't be able to do that, and I'm an account. If I try from all my business to save money and paid in one lump sum when April 15 comes next year. Now, you know what? He realizes that too. He says, well, that's very unlikely to happen. So do you know what he wants you to do?
Pay
quarter, right? Which is also difficult. And it's very difficult for that reason. Let's imagine that your taxes from your business is $20,000. If you do it quarterly, you are supposed to write $5,000 four times a year. First, number one, it's still a very big lump sum, which is very difficult to come up with when it's time to pay. Two, it's very weird schedule. The guy says quarterly. It's not quarterly. If you look at the timing of payment, to me quarterly would mean every 3 months. To him it means just four times a year, kind of random dates that were assigned. Very difficult to keep and very out of sync. So I don't recommend you doing that, even though that's his recommendation. My number nine would be, I would suggest that you make those payments monthly. Set up a date every month, the same date where you pay all your other bills, when you pay your mortgage, when you pay your utility bills, on the same day, make a habit to make a payment to the IRS. You can do it on the IRS website. Not with a credit card has a fee. But if it's a draw from your bank account on the IRS website, it cannot be done automatically. You cannot put it on autopilot. You will have to log in every month. But do it on the same day with your other bills. How you do it is very simple. Look what was last year. If you owe $10,000 last year to the IRS, so it's roughly $1,000 per month. Okay, do $1,000 per month this year. Or do a more accurate estimate. And finally, number 10 is this. Familiar with those signs? Anybody seen it? So the guys are trying to do what? Saving commissions, right? End up where? Where do they end up? Usually. In your office. Still paying your commission after they paid 6 months of mortgage, which they could have saved. Well, the same applies to my business. There are a lot of people a lot of realtors, I should say, who decided, well, I can do it myself and save on professional fee. So yes, and then they end up in my office again, you know, after it costs much more. So my suggestion there is find a professional, but a real one. Because just like in your business, there are a lot of professionals, and professionals are different. Of course, there is a part weight type of thing. No, I'm not going to sell you anything. Sorry if I disappointed you. I'm not selling anything today. But weight applies to one thing that I feel I need to mention. Not everything is bad. The general tone of the presentation was kind of negative. Oh yes, we are realtors. We are, well, that's not a very politically correct word, but we are in trouble. Let's say it nicely. Not everything is so bad. There are some things which he actually gives to you that he does not give to other people. And I'll talk briefly about owning rental properties. Anybody can own a rental property, and in fact, Blake will say it more strongly, they say everybody should own rental properties. Reason, financial reason to own rental properties, there are three reasons. In order of importance, I will list them. Number one reason to own rental property is appreciation. And when we say appreciation, this is what I refer to. Like, after a year of keeping the tenant there in the property, you come to him and saying, sir, your year has passed, now I'm raising your rent by $100 a month, and he says, you have no idea how much I appreciate that. So, appreciation of property means you bought that and years later it's more valuable, so you are building wealth that is either for you or for your children and grandchildren and generations to come. So that's number one reason, appreciation. Two, cash flow. So you should buy properties correctly where amount of rent you collect is more than expenses that it costs you to do. And number three, which is always cited by people who encourage you to own rental properties, oh, there are tax benefits. You save on taxes. Yes and no. Let's assume that you are a married couple, and between the two of you, you and your spouse, you make 150 grand in salaries from your combined jobs. And now you have your rental properties on the side, and you have tax losses, and you expect to get benefits. After this guy looks at your situation, he said, not that fast. It will not work for you. Why? Because between the two of you, you are making too much money. Believe it or not, 150 grand is too much money in the eyes of our government. However, if the two of you are making 150 or 250 or 550 or whatever, between the two of you, but let's say your spouse is an executive in a company, getting B-W-2, and you are a full-time realtor, you would not have that problem that most people would. As being a full-time realtor, you would qualify for a special treatment by the IRS called real estate professional. That's a complicated area which is a not do-it-yourself project, but that's something to be aware of. If you are a full-time realtor, you have this very unique benefit, which a lot of people would love to have, but cannot because they are not in your occupation. So, unlike some other people, you will get tax benefits from owning rental properties, so that's definitely one of the sweeter points of being in this business. And we will have a few minutes to entertain questions, guys. Thank you for being so patient with me and my partner.
Yes, ma'am. What is the application you use for the mileage in your phone?
What application I use for reporting expenses?
I
will not answer that question, sorry, okay. Will not answer questions directly. I will not name an application. This is why. There are literally dozens of them. And the right way about it is Google them and see reviews. But I want to give one very important warning that I will put next to that. I strongly recommend you to stay away from free apps. And not because I don't like free. Reason is different. Nothing is wrong with free. I like free as much as, hey, number one reason I'm here was a free lunch. Which I appreciate, guys, by the way. So, what happens with free apps is most of those apps are created by one guy in Argentina who had nothing better to do, and 5 months from now he's moving to something else. So as good as that app can be, when will you need it? 2-3 years from now. So when he knocks on your door and that application is no longer supported, you cannot get in the data from that if you are in trouble. So I would only suggest choose an app that has a big reputable company behind it, where you have assurance that it will be available years later and be supported. Support is way more important than cost, because the data has to be saved for multiple years. Yes, ma'am. The question was about expenses related to using your car. Let's talk about that. Look how much time we have.
Man, you got all day.
Do you serve dinner too?
Yeah, we need to start getting close to wrapping it up.
There are two ways to deduct use of your car. And that's very important information to know for you guys in your business in particular. Simple and complicated. Which one would you want?
Simple.
Okay, simple, I hear. Okay, simple is that. Simple requires mileage load. Okay, both of them require mileage load. But simple stops at mileage load. So if you have mileage load, which shows that you drove 10,000 miles for your realtor business during the year, or 20,000 miles, or 50, whatever number of miles. For each mile, you get a standard allowance. It changes from year to year. It's roughly 50 cents. Well, it's not 50, you know, whatever, 56 and a half right now, but does not matter, think 50. So you get a dollar for every 2 miles of driving. So if you drove 20,000 miles on your car, you get 10,000 deduction on your tax return. Okay, now, what is included there? Everything. So when we talk about, yes, you know, I have insurance, I have maintenance, I pay for gas, all of that is included. Tier and wear holds everything, like absolutely everything is covered in that number, nothing else. You can add only two things to that. There are two extras that you could add, which is a little strange why they added, but there are two extras. You can add portion of your interest that you pay on car loan, or you can add, not all, and you can add parking and tolls. Parking and tolls and interest, that's it. Everything else is included. So it's simple. Then there is the other one, complicated way. Complicated way still requires you to have a mileage law, because you need to determine business use percentage based on the law. So how many miles out of your total you actually drive for being a realtor. So let's say you look there and determine 80%. 80% business, 20% person. You get to deduct an 80% of real expenses. And now we're talking about as well. 80% of, 80% of gas, 80% of insurance premiums, 80% of oil changes, 80% of everything. And for the actual use of the car, there will be an accounting unit called depreciation, which is a way to deduct cost of car, so you will have 80% of depreciation. That is a complicated thing. Why anybody would bother? Because it could give you bigger deduction than going with miles. Not always, but it could. The only way to know for sure is to do both calculations and compare them side by side. And yes, there is small print that can make it a little more complicated than what I described, but basically these two methods. So if you want simple thing, just keep mileage and not worry about expenses. Want maximum deduction, keep it both ways. Keep mileage and track of everything that you spend related to your car, and then let your software, or better, your accountant, to calculate that. Okay, let's do two more questions at home. Okay.
Michael, a long time ago, and probably wasn't somebody, it wasn't you, I don't think, somebody said if I kept Acura track for 3 months of the mileage, yeah, then I could extrapolate that out to 1 year.
It probably was me. Okay. No, the question was about keeping mileage. Okay. What if you don't have mileage work for the entire year? So could you estimate it based on? Well, you could. That's the second best. It's still better to have mileage law, Frank. It's still better. You would have easier time dealing with him. But if you don't, here's what you can do. Do one work for the month of right now. We are starting August. August is partially done. So do September. Record it for the month of September. Then do it in December, in April, and in July. So that take 4 different sample months. If the law is similar in those months, he will understand if you do that. He said, look, I did it 1 month, then a little later another. I compared, all of them are pretty much the same. A little bit more, a little bit less. But if they start fluctuating wildly, it's not a good technique. Because if you see, it's okay, during December holiday season, I have so little activity. But right before school, I'm crazy busy. So your mileage load will be very different. And room for one more. Yes, ma'am.
For calculating Social Security down the road, do they look at gross income for that or net?
For calculating, I'm sorry.
Social Security.
You're talking about Social Security benefits at retirement? Do they look at that? That's a good question, but it's slightly outside of my zone. How exactly Social Security is calculated? You can go on the Social Security website, ssa.government, and they have a calculator built in, which actually allows you to do that. And it's even simpler. You could, that cost you nothing, you could actually call Social Security office and ask for that estimation. They will mail that to you.
Well, I don't get an estimation. I mean, like when the...
You mean, does it count that you work as an intern?
Do they look at your gross income for calculation or your net?
Oh, okay, got it. So the question was, if into your office comes 100,000 in commissions, but after you deduct all of the expenses, only 40 left on which you are paying taxes. So does 100 count or does 40 count? Is that the question?
Right, yeah.
40 is the one that counts. Because you are paying Social Security tax on the 40 after that. So that's what counts for their calculation. And I hope that we can live long enough where Social Security matters and that Social Security is still solid at that time that we get there. Wish you guys a whole lot of success in your very difficult business and keep my information handy in case my company can help. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. Well, guys, did y'all feel that was helpful?
Yes.
Thank you as always.
We can make pictures. In my log, I wear those glasses. We will posing for pictures.
I hope you got a strong camera. You're going to be in the picture, Michael. I'll tease it. Thing is, I'm bigger than him. He probably will be. Well, guys, we're about to wrap this thing up. Who here does anybody have any community outreach announcements or other industry rep announcements? Stand on up, sir.
Yeah, starting on 23rd of September, if you have I'm Richard Miranda. I'm with also with TARNA and ARNHR.
Did you stand up all 3 times?
All 3 times. I'm certified CIBS instructor.